Honeybees face many pest and pathogen stressors, and there are lots of ways to deal with these, but I really prefer that people take an integrated pest management approach when dealing with pests and pathogens. I'm going to use Varroa as my model to teach integrated pest management. Integrated pest management is not something that I created. It's not something that our colleagues here at the University of Florida created. This is a long-time thought process for controlling pests in many situations, in cropping systems and houses, things like that. And it's based on some very simple principles that I think extend especially to Varroa control. If I think about all the diseases and pests that honeybees encounter, to me, Varroa really match an integrated pest management strategy the best. And so let's think about that phrase, integrated pest management. When you look up pest control in the literature, on the web, etc., you will often see IPM. We're going to do things IPM, and that stands for integrated pest management. And IPM is based on some very fundamental principles. You've got to know what level of pest causes a problem. You've got to be able to determine when your, in this case, colony reaches that level of pest. And then you've got to know what to do to control it. The ultimate goal of IPM is to integrate multiple strategies to achieve maximum control of a particular pest. Now, in the best case scenario, in the ideal world, IPM would do away with the need to use chemicals altogether. But in practice, what IPM really does is it reduces the chemical burden placed in the colonies or in cropping systems or on trees, etc. It reduces that by integrating non-chemical control approaches to keep the disease or pest population as low as possible, as long as possible, and if you're simultaneously monitoring for that disease or pest, you'll know when it finally crosses that certain point that you then need to apply treatment. So I'm going to break down those constituent parts in this video. So first, I want to talk a little bit about the science associated with how to know about pest populations in a colony. I've got a simple chart. I've got a y-axis and an x-axis. For the x-axis, I'm just going to put time. So for purposes of easy discussion, I'm going to say this represents January. This represents December. So essentially, the x-axis is just walking us through the time of the year. Now, the y-axis would be the number of pests. So in our case, to teach it using Varroa, I'm just going to say, for ease of discussion, the number of Varroa. So over time, throughout the year, you could expect your Varroa populations to go up or down. So integrated pest management is reliant on really two numbers. The first of those numbers is the economic injury level, the EIL, and that's the population of pest that chemical control cost as much as the damage associated with the pest. Now, the second number that we think about in integrated pest management then is the economic threshold. Some people call this the action threshold. So if the economic injury level is the level at which Varroa is starting to cause economic damage in your hive, the economic threshold is the level at which you will treat to avoid reaching the economic injury level. Let's say that Varroa populations in January are very low. They start near zero. But throughout the year, they start to grow. And certainly in late summer and early fall, they peak. And then they may go back down as the population goes down, a bee population goes down in December. In theory, you hit the economic injury level for Varroa somewhere in late summer, early fall. So this is the point at which you are beginning to suffer economically. Your colony is dying. They're not making honey. They're not available to make splits, etc. Whatever the economic measure you are using, this is where you start to lose. So the idea of the economic threshold then is you would use this as a level to indicate where if you treated, you would bring that population of Varroa back down so that you never hit the economic injury level. So if you think then about this concept of economic injury level, this concept of economic threshold, under the umbrella of integrated pest management, integrated pest management then would be using as many non-chemical control strategies as possible to delay the Varroa population from ever reaching the economic threshold. So for example, maybe there's good genetics, maybe breeding for resistance, maybe using bottom screens, or any assortment of different things that you can do to your colonies to keep those Varroa populations lower longer may mean that this year you only hit the economic threshold once, if at all. In the perfect scenario, you would integrate a number of non-chemical control approaches to keep that Varroa population below the economic threshold indefinitely. But in the real world, the one in which we live, we can't do that with Varroa. Varroa will ultimately cross this economic threshold, and if we don't do something chemically there to address it, they would then reach the economic injury level, which is essentially the point of no return. The good news is, in the honeybee world, the economic threshold has been worked out for Varroa. Now, again, it's biology. Biology is messy. It all is dependent on the size of your colony, your location, the season, etc. But a good general rule of thumb is about 3 mites per 100 adult bees represents the economic threshold. So we as beekeepers are trying to keep those Varroa populations lower than 3 mites per 100 bees as long as possible, so that if we delay that, we may not have to treat this year, but if for some reason we're sampling and determining that Varroa hit that, then we have to treat. So how do we know when those Varroa populations reach the economic threshold? Being able to identify your pest, but also being able to sample your pest. It does me no good to know that the Varroa economic threshold is 3 mites per 100 bees if I can't recognize when I've got 3 mites per 100 bees in my colonies. The good news for us as beekeepers is there's a number of sampling strategies that we can use to estimate that Varroa population, those 3 mites per 100 bees. There's alcohol washes, powdered sugar shakes, and other things that we can do. Integrated pest management relies heavily on your ability to keep the pest low, those pest populations below the economic threshold, as best you can using non-chemical control approaches. And the way that this is best thought of is a pyramid. You almost always see this taught as the IPM pyramid. So thinking about integrated pest management as a pyramid, the bottom of that pyramid would be prevention. And like the name implies, that just means preventing the pest from being there in the first place. This is a very difficult thing for people to do in areas where Varroa are already present and absolutely everywhere. So for example, where I live in Florida, it would be very hard to prevent Varroa from being in my colony. But in theory, there are places in the world that you might can buy packages of bees or nukes that don't have Varroa, so you're starting your colonies with Varroa-free populations. There are other things that you might be able to do to prevent having Varroa in an area, for example, controlling swarming so that you're not releasing Varroa into the unchecked environment in feral colonies, government regulations that limit the movement of bees to prevent Varroa from reaching an area, etc. As you move up the IPM pyramid, you would next find yourself in the cultural control. In this category, you're really trying to make the hive environment less favorable for the pest, in our case, Varroa. And you might imagine that some of these cultural control measures might actually overlap with some of the prevention measures. For example, the use of hygienic stock, having a genetically resistant or tolerant population in that hive, can help culturally. Also, coordinating treatment among colonies, and not just among colonies, but among beekeepers in an area. All of these fall under the cultural umbrella. Mechanical control would be the next step up the pyramid, and this would be imposing something to change the environment or remove the pest. So if you think about it from Varroa perspective, a screened bottom board would be a mechanical control. It by itself does not reduce Varroa populations greatly. However, it does allow Varroa to fall out of the hive and it does reduce Varroa population some. So this is an example of a mechanical control strategy. You then move up into biological control, and it's based on the premise that everything that's alive has something that eats it or makes it sick. Of all of these strategies on the pyramid of integrated pest management for Varroa, this is probably the one that, while studied a lot, has turned up fewer examples of success stories. There have been some fungi that have been shown to kill Varroa, etc., but those have never really made it to market. Moving up from biological control, you then have chemical control. And so a lot of people erroneously believe that the purpose of integrated pest management is to eliminate chemical control. But in reality, chemical control always remains on the table as an alternative. And in fact, it would be arguably necessary if your varroa populations reach the economic threshold. And chemical control can be largely split into two categories. The more biopesticides or the more synthetic ones, you would think maybe from the biopesticide perspective in varroa control, things like thymol or formic acid-based treatments. And then, of course, the synthetic things would be such as amitraz or fluvalinate. Think once more about the umbrella of IPM. So in our honeybee colonies, we would be doing many different things to keep those varroa populations low. So for example, screen bottom boards, resistant stock, drone brood removal, whatever it is that you're doing non-chemically to keep varroa populations low, while simultaneously sampling to determine your varroa populations. In the perfect world, we'd be able to eliminate chemical control altogether. I know many of you watching this video will consider yourself treatment-free, or you haven't used treatments in a long time. That's all well and good, but managing thousands and thousands of colonies from a commercial scale is just really difficult to perform at the same level. So I believe a much better strategy to control varroa is integrated pest management, and hopefully you've learned something through this presentation on how to put together those various pieces to develop an appropriate varroa control strategy in your own operation.